threes, a couple of quick shots.
It was a game of runs in the first half. ETSU led the game 17-5. Mercer came back with an 18-0 run. And then the game settled down. It went back and forth. ETSU had 10 steals in that first half. Jerkin puts it through.
Nice job by the big fella. He didn't fumble. He kind of waited, let things settle, and then used the opposite side of the rim to shield himself.
Strawberry tries to lob one down for Fischler, but he throws it out of his reach. Bucks start this second half with Jerkin in there instead of Isaac Banks. Jerkin was a difference maker on the defensive side of the floor. Three of the four blocks for ETSU, courtesy of the 7-1 transfer from Indiana. It's Jerkin who sets the high screen. Cromer can't do anything with it. Off his foot, he lost it into the hands of Dimitri Rivers. Rivers decides to attack. He slips and falls down, and the Bears have turned it over on back-to-back possessions.
Two golden opportunities for the Bears. Leonard, the last one, just threw it too far for Fischler, and that time Rivers just slippery fell down and slipped.
Strawberry will replace him. Defensively, the Bears have done a very good job on the second leading scorer in the league, Jelon Gwynn. The last time Bob Hoffman watched Gwynn play, he put up a career-best 32 against Mercer. He's only hit one shot here today, though. Leonard trying to get into the hip of Gwynn, who throws it off of Jelks. And it was last touched by ETSU.
This is what we thought the first half might look like, the first couple of minutes out the gate. Just some uncertainty on both sides and turnovers. ETSU started fast, but not so much here in the second half. Both teams with some turnovers.
Leonard leaning in. That's a block on Bello.
Leonard took a hard fall there, but nice move. He turned down the ball screen by Brown when he saw McLean was leaning to his left. Not allowed to run into the lane and then Bello too late there.
ETSU not only started fast, they started with noticeable confidence, swag. They were bouncing around. They had grins. When they turned over Mercer, when they were hitting shots, there was a noticeable aura about them that hasn't been seen since Mercer answered that with an 18-0 run.
Well, a couple of things by Mercer. I thought that when they were getting pressed, they turned it over a couple times early, and then they went to a 1-4 across. Because really, ETSU's press man-to-man was kind of all or nothing. And so that allowed them to break it, create some fast break or two-on-one numbered situations, and so Steve Forbes called it off.
Phillip Leonard leads all scorers with 14 points. Two guards at the top of this zone here for the Bears. Strawberry chased out. Now Gwynn able to bump off of Stair, float one, and it doesn't fall down. Jerkin was there for the tip. He had to lay back.
Well, he did everything but go down. In fact, it was 10% of the way in the rim and then popped out.
ETSU swept Mercer in the regular season. Both were close games. One of them occurred when Mercer was playing very well, and one of them occurred down the stretch during the Bears' seven-game losing streak, but still the Bears played him to a three-point game. Here's Gwynn, left alone. That's his second bucket of the day.
He can certainly do that. You don't want him to get hot if you're Mercer. He's a guy that can score in bunches.
He does have 10 points. Both of his shots have been threes, and he's also been to the line a few times.
I know Bob Hoffman took Dimitri Rivers out a little while ago to talk to him about that turnover. I think he's a guy that's going to have to come back in.
Now Gwynn fouls the three-point shooter, Stair.
Boy, how many times yesterday and today have we seen jump shooters being fouled. Clearly, Gwynn tried to just put his hand in Stair's face, but leaned too much and knocked him down.
Stair, who has become a fixture in the starting lineup now the last 10 games. Freshman at a Hazel Green High School in Alabama. One more coming his way.
High IQ for Stair. I mean, he came in. I think that's part of the reason he was a little bit more ready than maybe other freshmen over the years for Bob Hoffman. In a really good basketball program. And he's aggressive, too. He's got a body that can kind of take some hits, much like Philip Leonard.
A foul after that one. Oh, we got a lane violation. I thought they called a foul on Lester Wilson. That makes more sense. Wouldn't have shocked me. We've seen a little bit of everything. So Stair gets an extra free throw. He hits 2 out of 4.
Mercer has mixed up their defenses here in the first couple of minutes. They played some man, they played zone.
McLean cuts down the middle of that zone because the ball was deflected. Gwynn couldn't launch the shot, but he collects it in the lane.
He's just athletic enough he can go get his own when the play breaks down or the shot clock runs down.
Here's Leonard weaving his way into the lane. Philip Leonard.
Oh, my goodness. Yesterday we saw him attack the rim. He didn't finish. He certainly did that time.
Wow, Philip Leonard. And it's Leonard who comes away with this one. A little more pedestrian. He just falls down to the deck while he banks this one through.
Well, he knew he could go at Petey McLean. He just didn't think he could jump over him, so he had to sidestep him right there. But 4 quick points by Leonard puts Mercer right back in this thing.
After what I just saw, I'd like to see him try and jump over Petey McLean. Cromer draws rein and buries the three, extending the lead back out to 4. That was a pretty confident-looking shot from Cromer.
Certainly was. Kind of that swagger we saw early in the game out of he and some of his teammates.
Leonard, again, pretty aggressive. They're going to get a foul. This time, I believe, on Petey McLean. Yesterday,